I was born in the north of England in 1926, a long time ago, another world. It's hard to connect who I am now with the girl and young woman who lived back there then. I had worked as a young woman in a variety of jobs, ending up doing secretarial work in the book publishing industry. When I was 25, I was fed up. I tried to get on in publishing, but it was a no-go for women at the time. I thought I could get a better secretarial job if I had an undergraduate degree, so I applied to the London School of Economics and was accepted. I took a degree in sociology with a major in social anthropology. I was fascinated. I came to the United States to go to graduate school at the University of California at Berkeley in 1955. I had met Bill Smith while I was studying at the London School of Economics, and we had decided to get married to pursue graduate studies at Berkeley. While I was working on my doctorate, we had two children, the last born 9 months before I finished, and then Bill left and we were divorced. It was a shock to be the one responsible not only for the children and household, but also for earning a living. I taught sociology at the University of California at Berkeley for a couple of years, but only had a lecturer position. This was around 1964 or 65, and women's issues were just becoming to be raised during my last 2 years at Berkeley. When I was teaching there, I was for the most time the only woman teaching in a faculty of 44, and of course, I was not in a regular position. Something was happening among women then. There was a big conference in San Francisco on the potential of women, and although all the main speakers were men, we women got together and talked. About that time also, a sociologist called Jesse Bernard had published a book on academic women which described the kinds of inequities women experience in the university. I gathered my courage together and put on a session with women graduate students in which I first went through the Berkeley calendar, describing for each department where women were. In history, there were none at all. In psychology, some eminent women who were, like myself, on temporary appointments. I then invited their stories, and they had many. I became involved in the formation of a women's action group at the University of British Columbia that worked to change the status of women at all levels of the university. I also became involved in establishing a women's research center in Vancouver outside the university and aiming at providing action-relevant research to women's organizations, and was part of building an organization among women academics that connected women faculty. In 1977, I went, accompanied by a group of graduate students, to teach in the sociology department at the Ontario Institute for Studies in Education. At that time, a remarkable place of openness to new thinking. I'd arrived at just after hiring another feminist, Margaret Etchler, and at the same time as Mary O'Brien. Though it wouldn't be true to say that OISE was progressive in views on women, the sociology department had a number of feminist students, and all of us working together were successful in introducing transformations that I don't think could have taken place at any other time anywhere else. It was there that I began to write a sociology for women, discovering and formulating an uneasiness that had indeed been there since my days at Berkeley, when even back then I thought that there was something very wrong with how sociologists thought and for the most part, still think. I wrote and published many papers after this, some political, among them a pamphlet called Feminism and Marxism, A Place to Begin, A Way to Go, and some more strictly out of research and thinking sociologically. In 1987, I discovered the power of publishing a book of my own. In 1986, Evelyn Fox Keller, then at Northeastern University, started a series of feminist books and asked me to do a collection of papers. The Everyday World is Problematic, a Feminist Sociology, was published in the next year. In 1990, I published two more collections of papers, The Conceptual Practice of Power, a Feminist Sociology of Knowledge, and Texts, Facts, and Femininity, Exploring the Relations of Ruling. And then in 1999, Writing the Social, Critique, Theory, and Investigation. Through the women's movement and its political practice of consciousness raising, were foundational to what I and others working with me have developed as an alternative sociology. A sociology cannot be confined to a particular category of people. If it is a sociology that explores the social from women's standpoint and aims to be able to spell out for women just how the everyday world of our experience is put together by relations that extend vastly beyond the everyday, then it has to work for both men and women. It has to be a sociology for people, as contrasted with the sociology in which I was so properly educated, the sociology in which people were objects, they whose behavior was to be explained. This book explicates institutional ethnography as a sociology that translates that concept into a method of inquiry. In my intellectual life, there have been three big moments. One was going to the London School of Economics when I was 26 and becoming fascinated with sociology. The second was a course given by Tomutsu Shibutani at Berkeley on George Herbert Mead, which laid the groundwork for a later deep involvement with the phenomenology of Maurice Merleau-Ponty. And finally, and perhaps biggest of all, the women's movement, which was for me a total transformation of consciousness at multiple levels. It led me into strange paths I'm still pursuing of undoing, among other things, the sociology I'd learned so thoroughly to practice. I learned from the women's movement to begin in my own experience and to start there in finding the voice that asserted the buried woman. I started to explore what it might mean to think sociologically from the place where I was, in body, living with my children in my home, and with those cares and consciousness that are integral to that work.
All right, guys, we've been in charge for like 10,000 years, and you can pretty much see the job we've done.
This is what a feminist looks like.
I have taken a great deal of pleasure in this quest for a sociology for women. Conceived simply, it is a sociology in and of the same world as that in which it's written and read, and relies on that world to complete the sense it can make. So it looks outward, towards discovering how people are actually putting things together. Its feminism is foundational, but not always its topic. Finding out how to do it, how to teach it as a skill to others, and what I can learn by practicing it is a continuing pleasure for me.